부위롭듯이 없듯이 모른 채 한다는 그거 너무나 가슴이 아픈 안타까운 일이에요. 사랑한다고 말하세요.
So now, please welcome 7 people from the performance group.
this beautiful autumn weather. I'm joining you here. I'm host Park Yun-young of today's opening ceremony. Nice to meet you. Glad to meet you. We are celebrating the 7th IAEC Asia Pacific Regional Network meeting, and the theme is the lifelong education, and it will be held for 2 days here in Gumi. And this will be a meaningful place where you can share your opinions and information. And we have on display the best practices of educating cities. I hope this will serve as a great opportunity where you can share your ideas and have communications with each other. Now let us begin the opening ceremony of the meeting. Thank you very much for taking time out of your busy schedule to be here, and I would like to welcome all the distinguished guests. When I introduce our distinguished guests, please welcome them with a big round of applause. Mayor Nam Yu-jin of Gumi City. Deputy Mayor Park Jae-yeon of Changwon City. Secretary General Marina Canals of the IAEC. Mr. Ichiro Miyazawa. Director Lee Kyung-un of Sahagu, Busan City. Chairman Kim Nam-sun of Lifelong Education Center. Superintendent Kim Jung-su of Gumi Office of Education. And also a lot of our officials from Lifelong Education in Gumi and Gyeongsangbuk-do have come here, and we have so many other distinguished guests here with us, but due to time constraints, I will just end it here. Now let us begin the opening ceremony of the 7th IAEC Asia Pacific Regional Network meeting. First of all, representing the citizens of Gumi, our mayor, Nam Yu-jin of Gumi City, will give the welcoming address. Please welcome him with a big round of applause.
Ladies and gentlemen, in this beautiful season, it gives me a great pleasure to see you in this great occasion. All the ladies and gentlemen from the IAEC and all the distinguished guests joining us here today, I'm very glad to announce the opening of the 7th IAEC Asia Pacific Regional Network meeting in Gumi. And I also would like to welcome all the educational experts, and also I'd like to welcome with 430,000 citizens of Gumi. I'd like to also like to thank Mayor An Sang-soo of Changwon City, and also Mr. Park Jae-hyun, Deputy Mayor of Changwon. And I also would like to thank the Secretary General Marina Canals of the IAEC, and I'd like to thank you for joining us. And especially, I'd like to recognize all the members and the experts of the related IAEC, and especially also the superintendent of Mokpo. I'd like to extend my great appreciation to you. And also Mr. Kim Jong-soo, thank you. And I'd like to also recognize that the importance, Mr. Kim Nam-sun, who will make a speech today. And also today, the speech will be delivered by Mr. Ichiro Iwazawa. I'd like to extend my special thanks to you. Gumi is one of the representing industrial cities, so it provides good environment for industry and banking, and also a good environment for education. So we have all the well aspects, good aspects of education and industry, and we are becoming the top leader of the world. So moving forward, so we will fulfill the charter of the IAEC education. So we will make sure that we practice what is said in the charter. So social integration and inclusiveness is the subject, it's the theme of this meeting. So this is the basic that we have to pursue. So taking this great opportunity, I'd like to see that the education and lifelong education is further promoted, and the Gumi and this sector can be more promoted toward the global arena. Once again, I'd like to thank all the ladies and gentlemen joining us today. So for two days, so I hope you enjoy the beauty of Gumo Mountain here at this area. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mayor, Mr. Nam.
Now, to celebrate the opening ceremony of the 7th IAEC Asia Pacific Regional Network meeting, Deputy Mayor Park Jae-yeon of Changwon City will give his opening address on behalf of Mayor An Sang-soo. Please welcome him with a big round of applause. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Park Jae-yeon, Deputy Mayor of Changwon City. Today, in this meaningful event, our Changwon Mayor An Sang-soo was to give his opening address here, but due to his busy schedule, I came here, I attended this meeting on behalf of him. Today, as we celebrate the 7th IAEC Asia Pacific Regional Network meeting, I would like to extend my gratitude to Mayor Nam Yoo-jin of Gumi and also Secretary General Marina Canals, who have come a long way from Spain. And also, Sahagu Bhutan, who is actively participating in IAEC activities, and all the officials who are joining in these efforts. It's my great pleasure to meet you. As a member city of the IAEC Executive Committee and Chair City of Asia Pacific, Changwon is a city consistently striving to develop and promote lifelong education to become a top-tier education city. As you all know, IAEC deals with and address all the urban issues by sharing information and opinions with each member cities. And we do this by and with the participation with our city residents. And as part of our efforts, all the experts from both Korea and abroad have come here to deal with urban issues for the sake of social integration and cohesion. This is what we do here at the regional network meeting. And in June 2016, in Rosario, Argentina, all the member cities of IAEC will gather to hold the 14th International Congress of Educating Cities. And there we will discuss a good living environment and enhanced quality. I hope many Asia Pacific member cities will participate in this Congress with strong interest. Once again, I deeply thank Gumi City Mayor Nam Yoo-jin and the IAEC Secretariat for your efforts on preparing for this event. And I would like to extend my gratitude to all of the organizers and officials. I wish you all happiness and success. Thank you very much. Deputy Mayor Park Jae-hyun has given the opening address. Thank you very much. And now, Secretary General Maria Canales will give her speech of encouragement. Please welcome her with a big round of applause.
Distinguished Mayor of Gumi, distinguished delegates, UNESCO representative, experts, ladies and gentlemen, it is an honor for me to participate at this 7th international meeting of the Asia-Pacific Network of the International Association of Educating Cities. I would like to thank the Mayor of Gumi for opening us the doors of the city and offering us good working conditions for this meeting. I would also like to acknowledge the rigorous work carried out by the City of Changwon as coordinating city of the Asia-Pacific Network. I thank you, all of you, for having accepted the invitation for dialogue and exchange. As stated in our founding charter, equal opportunities is the basic requirement for inclusion and a crucial topic for the IAEC. Our challenge is to work to make all the opportunities and services available in our cities accessible for each and every citizen. The United Nations has recently defined the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, and I would like to point out two of the 17 goals which certainly concern us and which specifically refer to inclusion. Objective 4 invites us to ensure inclusive and equitative quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all. And Objective 11 invites us to work to make cities and human settlements inclusive, safe, resilient, and sustainable. Having said this, I would like to note that poverty is not the only factor of social exclusion. Exclusion is a multidimensional structural phenomenon which may occur as an accumulation of adverse circumstances. Exclusion is related to social processes that lead certain individuals and groups and enables them to fully enjoy social rights. Consequently, social inclusion policies should take into account both people's material needs to lead a decent life, but also all other needs related to building social ties and to participate in the city's life. Since the early 60s, Korea has been one of the world's fastest growing economy, and still is. Korea has moved from being a recipient of international aid to being a donor, a benchmark model for many countries. This standing success was the result of setting education among the country's priorities together with the strong investments in the economy. Education has absorbed and still does a lot of public and private spending. However, while the economy has kept growing, unemployment rate has been rather low, 4% over the almost 20 last years, according to the OECD reports, Korea has one of the lowest levels of public social expenditure compared to other OECD countries. There have been improvements, though, but according to the OECD, regular salaried jobs with high salaries and good social benefits still represent a small percentage of total employment in Korea. The efforts to become a leading economy with highly competitive workforce must go hand in hand with concepts such as happiness and such solidarity. The risk to placing the efforts only in the economic growth and the development of the internal market may result in a consumer society where individuals place earnings at the top of their priorities and have less time to be involved neither in community work nor in non-formal education, altruistic or leisure activities. Korea has transformed itself in a society that attracts immigrants rather than a country which immigrants live. They come from all over the world, but you also have a massive influx of North Korean defectors from low social classes, their integration has been an issue into South Korea's workforce and a worrisome. Most of them are marginalized in the primary labor market and have a poor level of work integration. Inclusion of foreign-born wives is also an issue of concern in recent years. These marriages often face cultural discrimination, and they total about 10% of total weddings in Korea. Having broadly described Korean context, I would now like to try to provide you some inspiring examples of how to build more inclusive cities. We believe by far that the first step should be to build a single city, avoiding the conformation of ghettos. Secondly, to build a citizenship which is equal in rights and opportunities. Focusing our efforts on social policy, the right to free quality public health, fostering decentralization processes that strengthen citizen participation in public decisions, and fostering as well social integration with citizens having the same access to service, recreation, and culture. Attaining inclusive cities must be a collective joint venture that needs for a national, regional, and local multi-level approach, and a strong involvement of civil society with all its institutions and companies. In Korea, there are good examples of corporate social responsibility in large corporations. Local governments, as big purchasers of goods and services, have the potential to design public contracts to be more socially inclusive by including community benefits, such as those specifically targeted to the recruitment and training in favor of vulnerable population to ensure equal access to opportunities. This can contribute to generate a market for social enterprises, which can result in job creation for socially disadvantaged, foster ethical consumption, generating public awareness to reduce the social gap, changing consumption patterns of families, and so on. Local governments, as large employers, can also become models of conciliation by developing policies which allow flexible working hours for workers with young children or workers with dependent relatives, be them elder or disabled. These measures can also have a multiplier effect on other companies. Promoting civil society movements engaged in combating social exclusion, as well as promoting the creation of small enterprises aimed at the provision of social services by providing them with access to capital at low interest rates, is also a way to fight against social exclusion. Another best practice in promoting social economy are collective orchards or gardens, which produce food for those involved, keep the elderly active, bring them closer to nature, restructure the social tissue, and generate small incomes for those involved by creating a market for surplus ecological goods. As for migrant population, once their first needs such as work, housing, health, school are covered, their leisure, sportive, or cultural needs must also be met. Many IAEC member cities have succeeded in engaging this population in city festivals and other celebrations and encouraging them to create or join cultural associations. This helps them break their isolation. By doing so, you will be fostering social inclusion and cohesion and reinforcing the newcomer's identity and feelings of belonging. You will make their heritage and language known by the ensemble of the population, reducing fear towards the other, and thus contributing to create a more multicultural society. As for the elderly, there are many local initiatives aimed at active aging by promoting physical and mental wellness and reducing isolation. This should be a priority in local governments in Korea, where life expectancy has increased of 27 years in the last 50 years, and where suicide rates are one of the highest in the world, particularly for 60 and plus generation. These are just some of the examples. I invite you to visit our homepage and our data bank, where you will find more than 1,000 best practices from cities around the world. I sincerely hope that the ideas that will come out from our exchanges during these days will inspire our daily work and provide you with new tools to work so cities are more inclusive spaces, venues for learning, and better places to live together, which are designed with and for the people. I encourage you to continue to work for social inclusion from a holistic perspective and to address social inequalities to create economic opportunities for different sectors of the population. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your encouragement. Yeah.
It was a speech of encouragement by Secretary General Marina Kennels of the IAEC. Now, Superintendent Kim Jong-suk of Gumi Office of Education will give her congratulatory address. Please welcome her with a big round of applause. Nice to meet you. I'm Kim Jong-suk, Superintendent of Gumi Office of Education. I would like to congratulate Gumi City for the hosting of the IAEC Asia-Pacific Network meeting in this beautiful days of autumn. It's all the more meaningful that we are holding this event in Gumi, the city of tradition and IT industry. I would first like to welcome all of you, including representatives of IAEC member countries who traveled long distances to contribute to the development in lifelong education. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Korea has transitioned from a recipient of donation to a donor in the last three decades. And it was thanks to our great leaders of Korea. Sejong the Great invented the Korean alphabet, Hangul, because he wanted to help his people who could not write. And in modern history, we had other great leaders as well. For example, President Park Chung-hee introduced various education policies to help people develop their potentials and abilities. And these was due to and thanks to this passion of our leaders that Korea could become this developed and advanced. And the international community also contributed to this process. After the Korean War, Korea was the ashes of war, but it could actually rise as this advanced country, thanks to their help. I personally believe that education is a source of hope and growth for individuals, and education will give us lifelong hope and passion. Thanks to the development of ICT these days, regardless of gender or social class or physical condition, we can get education of any levels without any discrimination. I hope this year's IAEC Asia Pacific Network meeting will also serve as a great opportunity that enhances such movement and philosophy, bringing social cohesion and happiness to everyone. I hope this meeting will be a meaningful place to achieve all this. Gumi is a home of the Semal Undong movement and also the hometown of former President Park Chung-hee. And also we have Chaemijeong Pavilion very near to this venue where Yaeun Gilje taught his students, making Gumi an important educational place. Please have a little tour around this beautiful city, and I hope health, happiness, and success to all of you. Congratulations. Thank you. Superintendent Kim Jong-suk of Gumi Office of Education has given the congratulatory address. Now, we have all these other distinguished guests here, and lawmaker Kim Tae-hyun has given our congratulatory remarks to us. Thank you very much for organizing this meaningful event. Mayor of Gumi and all the organizers, I hope every corner of city is the educational place for all the residents. I hope you health and happiness. Please give lawmaker Kim Tae-yeon a big round of applause as well. Thank you.
The keynote speech will be brought by Mr. Kim Nam-sun, from Gyeongsangbuk-do Institute for Lifelong Education Director. So he's the PhD of Seoul National University. He's been the leader and the head of lifelong education in Gyeongsangbuk-do. He's been leading the advancement of Gyeongsangbuk-do lifelong education. Please welcome him with a big round of applause. Very nice to meet you. I'm Kim Nam-sun. I'm a professor at Daegu University, and also I'm in charge of education in Lifetime Education Institute, and I'm here as the head of education, Gyeongsangnam-do Institute for Lifelong Education. And also we're here with, this Kumi is part of IAEC. And for a long time that other cities besides Kumi have worked together to promote the city through education, and there have been many considerations and efforts. And in the center of such efforts, there has been Spain, and it has spread across Europe, and then it has suggested good models. So in this auspicious occasion, presenting this keynote speech is such an honor for me. Well, you know, from the early stage of being the member of IAEC, I started working as part of the team, and the city mayor had a keen interest in this effort. I also had a massive plan for making this city to be part of the IAEC, and the city-wise, the city and also mayor worked really hard to be part of that. And the mayor said, maybe I have better knowledge than you in terms of lifelong education. And I laughed and then asked, how do you know that well? And he said, when I was in the States, I learned a lot about lifelong education. And for a long time, he already recognized the importance, and he has been continuing to pursue the efforts. And in 1979, the Kakegawa city in Japan started the effort to be part of the IAEC. But maybe 1976, Kumi started providing lifelong education and training to workers. I mean, it didn't have the title like lifelong, but that was part of the efforts to provide trainings to workers. The name has been changed a little bit, and in starting from 1993, Changwon City already came up with Gu District, a community educational center. So starting from the 25 community centers, such effort, education effort has been going in Changwon City. And also in Gyeonggi, Gwangmyeong in 1990, it joined the it became the official education city. So I'd like to emphasize that Kumi started earlier such effort to provide lifelong education to workers and for the youth. So from my research, I've learned that Kumi is so special. It has put a lot of effort for such a long time. So the presentation I'd like to present to you today is how can we make citizens included and they have sense of belonging, and that we can achieve that a place where everybody can have decent life. So to make people to be smarter, wiser, of course they need to learn. Then that will boost the whole economy of the community. Maybe it's too natural and too easy to say. I'm sure you all know that the Korea has achieved economic growth at a fast pace. And like 1960s, the GDP level was only 72 per capita. But it actually, last year it marked 28,000. So it's a remarkable achievement. So from the ranking of the economic wise, Korea was one of the poorest countries in the past, but like 55 years past, the economic growth has been remarkable, and we are now top 10, one of the top 10. So that, you know, basically what helped us to grow further was the human resources, of course. As you know, we have less natural resources, but we had good human resources. So all the economic growth was centered around making people smarter. And then we found the answer in education. Gumi was one of the key players. For example, Gumi is the birthplace of Semal movement. Semal movement was only possible thanks to education. Semal education that led created leaders, and then the leaders spreaded the values of working hard. And then that helped us to move forward so quickly and then going fast in economic achievement. However, in reality, the direction that we pursued was toward economic development. But in terms of economic development policy, I mean, yes, in Korea that worked in Korea, but that also generated other side effects. One of the issues in Korea, I'd like to tell you two things. One is that the suicidal rate is one of the highest in the world. In 2014, per day, 38 people suicided. And the second one is Japan. 27.1 people committed suicide, and that followed by Hungary. But actually, the gap is quite high, about like 10 people between Korea and Japan. But from the second and third, there is about gap like 0.7. So it shows that the mental disparity and also the difficult mental difficulties across the country. So that triggers question if we are going the right direction as the suicidal rate shows. And the second is dislocation, the divorce rate of, in Korea is like one of the highest divorce rates in the world, like second tier. But although we achieved economic development, we have created other aspects like mental difficulties and a high divorce rate. But to become a truly advanced country, that we need to solve these problems first. But with the current educational public educational systems, we can't resolve those problems, because the current education system from the past and then present, that we are encouraging competition. You have to step on you have to step on somebody, so that doesn't value network and having like values in community. So if we continue to have such educational system, then what directions do you think we'll be going? And then we will go to the end, which has a very devastating result. So to complement that and to resolve that issue, that we need to find a solution that we can change people outside school. So which lies
answer in lifelong education. The things that you can't learn at school, like some social disruptions, that, you know, these things can be solved through lifelong education. So I'd like to tell you about social inclusion and what are the obstacles, and then what are these strategies that we can pursue to achieve social integrity. So what is good city? So from the perspective of local community, for example, Gumi city is a good city. So what is good city? It means citizens have to feel a sense of pride to be part of Gumi city. Here, people around this area, or especially industrial era, they must be proud of being part of it because they have good wealth. But if there are people who are marginalized from the economic benefits, and then their level of belonging to the society or community will be relatively low. And for the city, they should feel the sense of pride, and there should be something that they feel pride of. For example, Gumi is the birthplace of Park Jong-hee Present Park. Park Jong-hee, and he started all these Haemaeul movement, which triggered the economic development of the whole country. So this is maybe something that Gumi citizens can be proud of. And good city means a city where there are little conflicts, and the income gap is small, and the gap between societies and structural conflicts. Of course, there can be existing these problems, but these problems should, although they exist, there should be little. And also cultural activities are the important keys. So I researched what cities have the high level of happiness. So these cities need to have these qualifications. First is citizens have to have freedom of activities, and there should be something that citizens have to feel proud of. And the third one is the high level of sense of community. So first category, I'd like to talk about the city where all the citizens can make their living feeling free. Well, now Korea, we have many immigrants and North Korean defectors, but they also have to be included, and then they should not feel sense of you know, they should also feel the sense of inclusiveness. There are many factories around this area, and also the industrial complexes, and then there are immigrants and North Korean defectors working there. But I'd like to also make sure that there are no gaps like on immigrants or gender and sex or disability. And also there should be enough good space where you can have relax, and then you can enjoy things, where you can have some leisure time. And anywhere you should be able to walk around feeling safe. Korea is actually a very safe place to live. But especially, I have to emphasize that because safety is such an important issue. And universal design and barrier-free design is also one of the important aspects. And green space should be enough so that people can gather and then spend time together. And also the historical heritage and the modern aspect should coexist. Gumi has many historical heritage and also modern part of the industrial complex. So what is the aspect in between?
we have to think about, actually, we are living in the city of Gumi, where there are two parts coexisting, like old part and then modern part. So we have to make sure while working and living in this environment, if this kind of environment causes any disparity or discrimination. So the good city means where you can understand the values of the history and also the present. And the city of diversity and also the driving force for the further growth. So this city should provide a lot of good information, knowledge, and experience, and then where you can adapt to changes. So this is really important here. Of course, you have to constantly change your mindsets so that you can better adapt to changes of the world. So based on the knowledge and the tradition you have from the past, on top of that, you have to also constantly be able to evolve yourself, evolve your mindset. So by having different people's opinions, we have to build a democratic city, of course, and open a public opening space for public can share their knowledges and opinions is a good city. And another important aspect is this. Education program should be provided constantly to everybody. This includes public school education, but what I'm saying here is education besides public education. Because the world is constantly changing, and then this requires you to be to adapt new technologies, new skills. So this lifelong education should provide such new skills to especially marginalized people. So the good city means that everybody's welcome to this program. One of the problems in Korea is that, especially in lifelong education, about 35% of the total population are attending the lifelong education, but 35 is also some duplicates. For example, the one person can go to the morning class and then go to the afternoon class, and then one person is counted as two. So the actual ratio of the population who join the lifelong education is like about 20%, and then the details of such figures give me a great concern. And because if lifelong education is not properly provided, then they can cause problems, like much serious problems, social problems. And this is the same in Gumi. Many are joining education, lifelong education, but problem is that most of them are well-educated and well-fed and already quite rich, and then many are female. Here we have mayor of Gumi, and Gumi, the city, was putting a lot of efforts and a lot of budget in lifelong education. Well, I'm specifically talking about Gumi because we're in Gumi. And there is a center for lifelong education, but who are the students? We need to look at that closely. So who are coming from what regions, what community, how much diversity we have. So that should be open to all of the citizens. So how many ratio of Gumi citizens are enjoying such education? So these analytic efforts should be properly done, because lifelong education is something that anybody can learn anything they need during their life cycle. But we also need to ask ourselves if we're actually providing that education to all of the citizens. I'm also the head of Gyeongsangbuk-do Institute for Lifelong Education Director. But for decision makers, what is really important is building a center or building the facility, and then they're happy about it. But we need to look into it closely and to see who are using the facility. So you go to the lifelong centers, then you can learn everything from health, how to earn money, habits. There are so many programs. But we have to be careful if there are only people who are already rich and who are already well-educated, then there will be further gap between the well-educated people and the marginalized people. And the gap is widening. So the rich people are already got everything, but they are now learning more things, and then that is widening more gap. So that is polarizing the educational gaps. And then this is actually ironically playing negative role in having some social, in achieving social integrity. The lifelong act in Korea says that all the education should be provided equally to all citizens. However, if you go to the scene, you can see disparity, and there are some gaps that you can see clearly, then that will cause a knowledge gap, and then that will also that will cause social gap. We're living in the IT world where knowledge is everything. Knowledge is the money. So knowledge is something that you have to learn, constantly update to learn things and to learn new skills. So, but this polarization will make marginalized people more, put them in a more difficult situation. And especially for marginalized people, we have to pay more attention. That is why I'm emphasizing it. So to do that, I also talked about the reasons why there can be some social exclusions. In the past, agriculture was the key in making money. So that was quite simple. Everybody was working in the field. But in here, diverse society, people work in a different environment. And then each job and profession requires different knowledges and skills. So already, before you join or you get a job, that there is disparity of knowledge existing already. And because of the limited resources, things are not evenly distributed to all the society. Therefore, again, the polarization becomes really severe. Therefore, age, by sex, by ethnicity, all by sectors, there can be some disparities. So I'll skip this. So let's look at this as a city model to make an equal city population, which means citizens, they have to be part of group so that they can learn something. T means technology, so it's skills that are required for jobs, maybe. So these four elements have to be balanced. And then this helps community to further develop. But the key here is population. If the system doesn't assist this model. So for example, the human beings, the populations are not equally treated, then that is a real big issue. So when a population see the changes, that they can be entitled to positive changes. So these four elements are working harmoniously, then you can make a good city model. Here I'm talking about again education, because education is all the basic, is the foundation of all basics, all changes. I'm sure that you can understand this. A researcher, McLean, suggested this model. So if citizens are given lifelong education, and then you can achieve a city where politics, administration, and all the economies are stabilized. For example, you have to elect a lawmaker, then you have to know who is the right person to choose. Then only well-educated people can make such a decision. And also to boost economic growth, you need to have well-skilled workers. And when cultural diversity is respected, of course, that promotes the sense of well-being. So what are the strategies that we can do that we can achieve social integration through education? Like I told you, all the citizens have to be able to join lifelong education, and each city has to share such vision. So this vision is not an absurd one. It should be specifically, it should be very specific, so the citizens can actually see and feel that. Without sustainable development, educational development cannot be achieved as well. So the citizens need to realize that. If they don't know that they don't know, they don't realize they don't know, that it means they are not properly educated. Because the more that you are not aware that you don't have enough knowledge, then you become more vulnerable to such lack of knowledge. But well-educated people, they realize, I think I'm missing this information. So these widening the gap. So it is important to let everybody know that what skills or what knowledge they are missing. So it is important to encouraging all the citizens to know what areas that they are lacking. So education is the driving force of the individuals and economic development. And also there are some disparities and some cultural inequality because of the information is fed so fast. And all the citizens need to realize that the resources are limited. So by systematically making the framework, all citizens have to be invited to lifelong education. So in terms of social inclusion, all the obstacles that hinder achieving social integration should be resolved. So this kind of framework needs to be set by cities. So again, these problems should be solved by education. So we have to find answer in education. And also, citizens need to understand clearly what are the values that each city is pursuing. Whether it's a country or a city, all individuals need to have this in life. But what is the key making that possible? How can Gumi City and Changwon City make people happy? So we need to have a clear vision on that. So by have an open city, all the new cultures can be invited. And subcultures and values are existing. But there are different subcultures, although in one city, for example, Gumi City, there are different subcultures in different sectors and different locations. And also we have an increasing number of marriage immigrants, and also we need to come up with an integrated educational strategy to include them. So in Gyeongsangbuk-do, our institute has been in leading in enhancing accessibility to lifelong education. There must be some people who can't go to the center because they don't have enough time or because they live far. But we are we're promoting leaders who can go to the community centers where they can go to each part of the location so that more people can be part of lifelong education. Well, Gyeongsangbuk-do, this upper part of Gyeongsang province, is quite big. But however, compared to the size, the centers where provide lifelong education is limited. So we're now using different facilities like community facilities, so they are turned into lifelong educational centers. So the elderly and disabled people can go to the community center and learn the skills and the time when they want. Some of them are living very far, and also they can't make, like, for example, in the morning or in the afternoon. So we're opening classes for them, especially when they want. So we have set the classes for their specific requirements. So we're encouraging, we're promoting these leaders, so that I'd like to see further active participation of all the citizens in a small group at community centers. And also for immigrants, we are working to provide better conditions for them to better adapt into the current society. And especially there are educational programs for North Korean defectors, because they need to understand the difference between Korea and South Korea and North Korea. And also they need to know the trends of the globalization and what are the differences in life values in South and North Korea. Because such differences in the two countries, North Korean defectors are finding difficulties in settling down here. So the education is open to them, and more educational programs are being developed. That was quite a long presentation, and I didn't even have time to look at the clock, but did I manage my time? Yeah? Thank you. So I did my best to deliver my presentation in time, and I hope you could understand. Thank you very much.
Please give our presenter another big round of applause.